Arlington Street, Reading, Massachusetts. The proposal does not conform to the required yard setback of 15 feet. Unless there's any objection, I'll dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that the abutters were notified, as were all the required boards and committees in town, as well as the members and associate members of the Board of Appeals and the planning boards of the surrounding communities. Testimony on this case given before this board is taken under oath. So if you think you're going to want to speak on this petition in any way, shape, or form, you need to be sworn in. So if you're going to say anything, even if you're a member of the public, the applicant, otherwise, please stand and raise your right hand. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and the responses I do.
I do.
Thank you. With that...
No, you can say you've been sworn in, and you have to go to court.
With that, we will let the applicant present your case.
Thank you very much. Good evening, Chairman Fornelio and the board. Really appreciate giving us the opportunity to present our case. As an introduction, my name is Alex Kablonski. I'm here with my wife, Lindsay Avery. We're the owners of 17 Arlington Street. With us today is Andre Avery of Andre Avery Designs, who happens to be my wife's mother, and her team, our general contractor, Ethan Dow, from Dow Construction. And both have about 30 years of experience in the commercial and residential development in the North Shore area, and they've been helping us with this project. We're here today to request for a special permit for renovations of our home. We bought our home back in 2015, and for the purposes of, we were attracted to the location, the neighborhood, as well as the character of the house and the town of Reading. When we bought it, we've always wanted to do some renovations to the house, not only to improve the quality and the structure of the house, but also allow us to possibly grow as a family in the house. Today, as you know, the special permit is in accordance. We're looking for in accordance to the 7.3.2 of the zoning bylaws because of the side setback is not within the 15 feet. I will say that we're not asking for a variance, and we designed the structure so that there's no need for a variance. We'll also mention that the designs are under the coverage lot of under 25%, and want to be emphasize that we're not increasing on the encroachment of the property as a result of any designs of either the addition or the deck. In your documents, you have detailed copies of their existing proposed plot plans, detailed design plans, as well as stamp-certified structural engineer plans from McBride Structural Engineers. The aim of it is to build, as you can see, the design. So the aim is to build a two-story addition. I will point out that the majority of the work is actually being done, is being done actually inside the interior of the house. And so the need for the special permit is for actually only a small portion of the renovations, where we're actually basically just cornering out the back corner of the house as it relates to adjacent lot 160. And so as you can see, that is being done where it's actually a current existing structure today, being the current deck. Also want to point out that the ask for the 13.4 by 17.1 deck addition is the purpose is to replace the current deck that's being torn down as a result of the a modification of the two-story addition. And what we're doing is the replacement deck is relatively the same footprint of the current deck. We're just pushing it out to just a couple of feet to fit the new alignment of the house. I'll point out that, once again, neither the two-story addition nor the deck is increasing any of the encroachment of the property, of the setback compared to the existing structure. Also want to point out the height of the two-story addition is well under the neighboring houses around us. We are increasing the height of the addition so that it can accommodate the second floor plan to be decode, because the existing structure, the second floor actually has knee walls and as well, we wanted to not have that in the addition portion. The addition roof also, we'll also note, is gonna be pitched identical to the current pitch of the existing structure, front structure. To be transparent, we have started work on the house already. We've been doing renovations primarily in the interior per the permits that have been, we have received. Work included enhancing the structural supports of the house structure based on structural engineering recommendations, removal of the non-load bearing wall, removing of the chimney due to identified significant water damage of the chimney, and an oil to gas conversion of the HVAC system to help our energy efficiency. And so, in preparation of this meeting, we did reach out to our neighbors, and particularly some of our direct abutters, and particularly lots 160, 158, and 169. Some actually are here today. All abutters that we've talked to have provided favorable responses to the additions. So, with that, I would say that the renovations that we're looking to do, we believe, is not only improving the quality of our house, but the neighborhood. Hope you agree. And with that, happy to open up to any questions from the board.
Great. Thanks so much. Before we get into board comment, I'd like to just read the building inspector's comments into the record, and then we'll give the my fellow board members a chance to comment, ask questions. We have an email comment from Glenn Redmond, the building inspector, dated Thursday, February 16, 2017, case 1621. Case 1621 is a proposal to add an addition 8.8 by 12.9 and to add a deck 13.4 feet by 17.1. feet to the right-hand side of an existing dwelling. The proposed setback is 10.8 feet, which does not comply with the required setback of 15 feet in an S15 district. A special permit under Section 732 of the Town of Reading zoning bylaws would be required in order to proceed with this project. I do not have any concerns if a special permit is granted for this proposal. Just want to make sure that was made part of the record and read into the record. With that, we'll start with board comments. And Kathy, if you'd like to start, do you have any questions or comments for the applicant?
I really don't have a lot of questions. I was happy to see that what you put forward doesn't encroach any more on the setback, so I think that was a positive. But I really don't have a lot of questions, so thank you.
John. Thanks, Kathy.
Your calculations buildable portion of the lot come out to be 24.96% by what I can see here. So whoever did the calculations, that included the shed, I would assume.
Correct.
Did a very masterful job in doing the calculations. One question that I did have, the addition to the rear, which is in a set of drawings that I think you did the favor. It appears that the roof line is the same as a continuation of the existing roof line, so it's just extended out towards the rear?
Correct.
Okay. The roof line looked the same, but I didn't know about if the height went up. Addition.
Yes. So the height is 4 feet above the existing roof line. But the pitch of the new addition versus the front portion of the house will be the same pitch.
Okay. I had a question. You're aware, I'm sure, because you seem to be very well prepared. So under 732, the board must make a finding first that the construction, addition, extension, alteration is basically no more substantially detrimental to the neighborhood than existing non-conforming building or structure in the neighborhood. So that's the first thing that the board is going to have to do tonight. Did you want to address that before the board?
I would say that, you know, we've been very thoughtful of the renovations to be not only taking into account the property as the house, but also the neighborhood. And so we believe the renovations are going to be, actually will be viewed as a benefit to the neighborhood. As per some of the abutters have advised, we've actually designed some dynamics to the house to also literally take that into account as well. For example, we actually, if you looked at the designs, the second floor footprint is actually smaller than this first floor footprint because we actually gave a 5-foot relief to our abutters on to I guess if you're looking at our house to the left, because that is the there's this close proximity house to us as our neighbors. And so the second floor is actually not as close as we could have put it in the designs.
That I guess I missed. It's still 10.8 feet away from the property line.
Yeah, I'm talking about the other side of the house. So it's has nothing to do with the setback. It's just a design that to improve, like, the acceleration of the neighborhood.
Well, as I drove by today, I noticed that you already have three building permits in the window out front. So I can see that you're doing, and that was for the gas conversion. You said there's some reconstruction on the walls, support walls.
I think we have. Is there another one for the bathroom?
Yeah.
And a plumbing one?
On the second floor, removal of all interior, non-bearing walls upstairs. And nothing on the outside of the house.
Yeah. You certainly do have an extremely small lot. You're making the most of the lot and the house, of course. Other than that, I don't see any. Any other questions that I had on it seem to be pretty much straightforward.
Right. Thanks, John. Sai.
I think this is a very straightforward case presentation. Existing nonconformity is already 10.8. You are not creating a new nonconformity. You're basically taking down the deck that's there, replacing it with an addition and a new deck, which basically extends the length of the house by about 8 feet, by my calculation. So I think it's a pretty straightforward request, and I have, frankly, no problem with it at all.
Thank you, Si.
Eric?
Candidly, I have nothing to add that hasn't already been covered.
Good. Very good. I echo the board members. I guess what I don't see any, maybe I've missed them. I don't see, or maybe I should see. I don't see a statement of how the difference in elevation from the existing roof line to the new roof line. You said it's 4 feet higher than the existing roof line. The addition will be, right?
Correct.
What's the current roof line and what's the new roof line going
to
be?
The current roof line was measured to be 29 feet. And the new roof line will be 4 feet higher at 33 feet.
All right. So still within what we expect. Excuse me? Yeah, still within the 35 feet, right. I think then, yeah, and that's pretty much all I have. I mean, I guess the board will make a determination and a finding regarding the substantially more detrimental piece. You're not encroaching any further into the side yard setback, and frankly, you're just extending further into your backyard along the same line. So that doesn't trouble me, and I don't think that runs afoul of the intent and spirit of the bylaw. I will go ahead and turn the hearing over to a public comment section, and as I do that, if there are any members of the audience that would like to speak, please let me know and we'll give you that opportunity. We did get a note from somebody who appears to be a neighbor of yours, a Ruth Coppola of 128 Woburn Street, dated February 9th, addressed to me. Just a note to say I have no objections to my neighbor's plan to construct a two-story addition to the property at 17 Arlington Street. Just put that into the record as well. in addition to the building inspector's comments. Is there anybody who'd like to speak? Please.
Cadence Thomases. I live at 21 Arlington Street. My mother is the owner of that home. I believe that's 158. You're 159.
Yes.
Okay, so we're 158. We are direct abutters. We are separated. Our homes are separated by the width of one car driveway length or width. These are great neighbors. We're really glad that we've gained these neighbors in the past couple of years. I wanted to say also, because of who is currently behind me, we are one of only two houses that sit between this particular property and that property, Zucker's Doucette project, properties that are lived in by the homeowners. So put this in a particular position in this meeting. These are great neighbors. These are transit-oriented neighbors. These are the early adopters of the idea of living close to the train and taking the train to work. I've looked at the project. I've been inside their home, and we've looked at it together. It looks very reasonable to me. I just want to add my voice in support that this is the kind of development that seems to be a really positive addition to our community. And as this couple wants to potentially have a larger family, I think that what they're asking for is very reasonable. And I just want the board to know that they have neighbors who are in support of the reasonable addition that they're wanting to build.
What's that?
Future contribution. Oh, yeah. Oh, and we've also talked about the potential for future contributions that they may make to our civic life in town. We talked about town meeting and et cetera, running for boards in the future. So this is really a couple that we want to keep in this community. And I just encourage the board to look favorably upon this request. Thank you.
Thank you. Jump in anytime the water's freezing. Volunteer life or elected life in town. Anybody else like to speak on the application? Hearing none, I'll close the public portion of the hearing. Do the board members have anything else to add? Would you like to say something? Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I saw you. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw your hand. Any other board members like to speak on the application or have any further questions based upon what we've heard? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion. Bueller? Hello, Kathy.
You want to do that?
Sure. We move to approve the petition of Alexander Koblansky, who seeks a special permit under section 7.3.2 of the zoning bylaws in order to construct an 8.8 by 12.92 story addition and a 13.4 by 17.1 deck as per the plans on the property located at 17 Arlington Street in Reading, Massachusetts. And we've all submitted a couple of plans. The first is a plot plan dated November 2nd, 2016. It was prepared by LeBlanc Survey Associates, 161 Holton Street, Danvers, Mass. And it was stamped by, Vernon J. LeBlanc, professional land surveyor. We've also submitted a plot plan prepared by LeBlanc Survey Associates, 161 Holton Street, Danvers, Mass. Dated August 9th, 2016, and also stamped by Vernon J. LeBlanc, professional land surveyor. There were some other plans, I do believe.
There were some elevation drawings.
Mm-hmm. Elevation drawings. It was dated October 21st, 2016, by Koblansky Avery Residence.
There's some figures, S1 through S.
Yeah, there's S1 through S4, dated September 29th, 2016, and it looks like they were prepared by McBree LLC Structural Design and Sales. Is that it? I think that was it. We would also...
We also need to do a finding.
Finding. Mm-hmm. That the such reconstruction, extension, alteration, or structural change shall not be substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the existing non-conforming building or structure. And I also think we usually put some conditions on any special permit that is approved by the board, and it's conditioned upon the following. The petitioner shall submit to the building inspector a certified plot plan of the proposed construction and proposed foundation plans prior to the issuance of a foundation permit for the work. The Petitioner's final construction plans for the new structure shall be submitted to the building inspector along with the as-built foundation plans prior to the issuance of the building permit. And the as-built plan showing the completed construction shall be submitted to the building inspector immediately after the work is completed and prior to the issuance of the occupancy permit. Okay. Anything else?
I think that captures it all.
Right. I think there's two motions there, so I think we need to vote independently on the two.
We need to vote on, let's vote first on a finding.
The finding. Yeah.
And then vote on the underlying motion to approve the application. So.
I would second Kathy's two motions then.
Okay. All right. And then, so first, the first part of that motion is, we have a motion and a second. And the first portion of that we're gonna vote on is a finding by the board that the application is not substantially detrimental to the surrounding neighborhood. And so all of those in favor of a finding, voting up that portion of the motion, all those in favor. Right, 500. That portion is approved, that finding has been made. We have a motion and a second to approve the application for a special permit under 7.3.2. That's been seconded. Any discussion on that? All those in favor? 500. Your petition is granted. Hang out for a minute. I'm going to stamp your plans, and we'll get you on your way.
Excellent.
Thank you.
We'll have that decision written up in about 14 days. Then there's a 20-day appeal period, so probably somewhere is around month and a half from today, you could probably pick it up at the town offices. Call for it.
We're not far off.
S1 through S4, and then there was some. Are we doing just, was it just one page, a front page, or all those drawings?
I'd stamp just one page.
Well, no, I'm not going to stamp them all. Are we including this entire package of drawings, or just that front page?
Well, since you have them, you might as well.
I'm going to stamp the front page and include them all as a figure.
And then we
there you go. Clip's working. That one got any in it?
I don't know.
Am I 0 for 2?
Try.
0 for 2. It's all right. We got paper clips. That'll do just fine.
Is that the big one?
Here are your plans and drawings, sir. You need these to go along with your decision.
Excellent.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night. Thanks, Kathy, for doing that.
Oh, no problem.
All right. Next item on the agenda is board discussion, continued board discussion, on the most recent draft decision on the Reading Village 40B project. Chris, I know, sent two copies. One a marked up copy, one a clean copy.
Yep.
That I didn't bring with me, but I did look at.
I've got copies.
I don't have them either, okay. On my phone.
One a marked up copy containing what should have been the board comments from last time we met, and one a clean copy showing that, that those comments were incorporated.
Yeah, I apologize not for giving you guys more lead time with that draft,
Sorry, we're used to that.
But that is what I said, both documents, the same document really, in two different forms. But both represent my attempt to capture what, all of the suggestions that the board members offered last time around.
So I, for one, look, I did look at both. They're probably still sitting on the printer in my office when I printed them. And I don't have any further. I didn't have any further comments or questions. It appeared that we covered most, if not all, of the items that we needed to cover, and you did a good job working them in where they needed to be. So from my standpoint, I'm comfortable with the decision. So let's give the other board members a chance to have at it. Any other any questions from others? This is board discussion. We don't have to take them in order. If you got something to say, say it.
Okay. I guess the first one starts on page 15, which is the construction schedule and staging plan.
Mm-hmm.
Goes over to page 16, listing them through J. We talked about finding an off-site parking facilities for the workers.
Yep.
But I didn't see it in there.
Actually, what I think I may have misunderstood the comment from last time. There is something in here, although it's not in this condition, that says they have to park all of their construction vehicles within the property. But let me see where I put that.
No, we don't want them within the property.
We want them to find an offsite. Yeah, that's what I did not add, but will now do. I'm more used to it in other construction settings. It doesn't really work here, but in some of the more rural towns, when you have a 40B project like this, then you have a condition that says you got to park all your vehicles on the property itself. So I was drawing from that here, but I will revise condition 4 to make it clear that they can. I guess I'd suggest that they can park construction vehicles on their own property, but we should also ought to have the ability to establish an off-site parking location subject to review and approval by the community development department.
The only reason I'm concerned about that is because of the number of people who will be in the, once it's torn down, you start to do the preparation, the land site preparation, and then actually start building. You're occupying, 50%, 57% of the property for the structure, so there's not going to be room for people to park and do preparation at the same time, so.
That doesn't sound unreasonable.
Yeah, no, I can add that in.
That's fine.
And the second item was on page 21. Did you delete that whole section, which was a description of the parking and the 13 additional spaces?
I moved it. So that was under condition 32A, which was under the heading prior to the issuance of any certificate of occupancy. So what I did was I moved it out of that section. And I moved it. And I moved it into what is now condition 37. which is conditions for on, which is under the category conditions for ongoing operation and maintenance after occupancy. So I wanted to make sure that that condition, the parking condition, didn't appear as a one-time thing they needed to do within the construction sequence. That's a, that's an arrangement that's going to remain in place, you know, long after they're done with construction. So it's modified, and so it's not exactly the same. It's modified slightly, and it was moved from page 21, well, the middle of page 21 to
bottom.
The bottom in what is now condition 37.
Okay. The section of that that was in yellow that you moved, I assume it would have been part of 37. The former, the top of 37, I guess, was, I don't remember how everybody else felt, but I felt that the 13 remaining spaces need to be allocated towards visitor spaces rather than allowing 8 of the 13 to be then, after it's completed, to be, what would you say, re-leased?
Released
to
unit owners,
to other owners, because I think that no matter how you do it, visitor spaces are top priority, and if you have basically one parking space per unit right now, the 68, the remaining 13 gives you the 1.25. But it doesn't give you that much of a visitor space if you're going to take off 8 of the 13 spaces at a future date. So it limits the amount of spaces that you're going to have, which after hours is not a problem. I mean, it's after 6 o'clock at night or so, that's not a problem. And probably on weekends it's not a problem because you have that whole MBTA parking facility and you're not going to worry about that. But for the neighbors, and that is an issue when you're using the, not you, but I mean the development uses the street parking for a lot of that too. I mean, everybody has to share. But that's just my comment. I don't know how the rest of the board feels about that.
My recollection from our discussion last time, I think we were, I don't know that we were all, I don't think we were all in agreement on
no,
this.
No, we didn't poll the board on that.
So your proposal is that the language be changed to all 13 spaces remain unassigned or?
Unassigned, available for visitor parking.
Unassigned, and take out, maybe rented to individual tenants as second on-site spaces?
Mm-hmm. And what I also didn't see in there, but maybe I missed it, was that each unit would be assigned a space on the property. And that's up to the developer how to assign those. I know in new construction, you got closer to the door if you were one of the earlier people who were coming in to lease an apartment at the facility.
So the way it reads right now is there'll be at least 5 spaces that should always be visitor spaces if we read that sort of, if we back into that. So if 8 of the remaining spaces shall remain unassigned, at which time those 8 spaces may be rented to individual tenants as second on-site, and the remaining 5, yeah, right, the next line, the remaining 5 shall be designated. So those 5 of those 13 will always be designated as visitor. Your suggestion is that all 13 be
correct.
Designated as visitor and not be
reassigned or released.
In which case, from a building management perspective, if there aren't 13 visitors that need to use those spaces, you'll have tenants that
just want to use those spaces and may use them anyway.
Well, I mean, it's going to be first come, first served type of thing.
Well, I mean, that's what it's going to end up. And then, and so...
No matter how you do it, it doesn't make any difference. Parking is always a problem when you have a development, period. So there's going to be people who are going to be, I'm only going to park there for 15 minutes, and I know you don't get home until later. Well, you got home early that day, and you can't get into your space, so you're a little bit upset. So what do? You call the tow company, and the tow company comes in and tows your vehicle out of there. All of that becomes a problem for the development, or in terms of this, because they're all rental units, it becomes a management issue.
Yeah, it's always going to remain a management issue. So, you know, candidly, I'm of the opinion that I for units that are multi-car units, I think if they're gonna, as a building management process, they're gonna offer those up as permanent spaces assigned or leased or rented or however they're gonna do it to a particular unit owner. I think I'd rather see that than see a mad scramble for 13 visitor spaces. It seems like it would be more orderly. There'll always be 5 visitor spaces, designated visitor spaces. Mm-hmm. If there are 8 multi-car tenants, up to 8 multi-car tenants in the facility, would you rather see them fighting over the, or more, fighting over the 13 visitor spaces, in which case if they don't get them, then they encroach on the street more or the neighbors more, or would we rather see as a matter of course that they're given an opportunity to get an additional full-time assigned space, or however they're going to do it, whether, you know, they could always do it differently too. They could say you can, unit one can park there during the day and then they're gone at night, and unit two can park in that space at night when they come home from work. You know, there are different ways for them to do it to maximize the use of those spaces. But what I'm saying is if we're dealing with a situation where it's not the assignment of those extra spaces to multi-car tenants is not formalized, then you're going to have a lot of scrambling for those spaces and probably more impact on the neighborhood. Whereas if you give the management an opportunity to assign them to a multi-car tenant, there's a better chance that they'll all be concentrated on site and not be looking off site.
Okay, you have eight that you can do that presently in. However, you have 18 potential multi-car units rented out, 11 two-bedroom units and 7 three-bedroom units. I mean,
it's got to be first come, first serve anyways when they allow, you know, when the building management announces, okay, we're at 100% occupancy, or they're going to tell tenants that come in saying, hey, I'd like to rent the unit, but I've got 2 cars, I want an extra space. The message is going to be, well, you only get 1 space for now. Once the building is 100% tenanted, you know, we'll put you on a list, or however they're going to do it. You know, first come, first serve. And, you know, however they do it, whether it's the first 8 multi-car tenants that request an extra space get it, or whether or not they do it by lottery, or, you know, pick numbers out of a hat. I think it's still better to have a concrete, I think it's better to have a concrete rule to make sure you're keeping more resident cars on site than do it by voluntarily or randomly, so that you have all of those 18 multi-car units vying for those 8 spaces and fighting over it, rather than knowing that only 8 of those 18 multi-car tenants are going to get an extra spot.
Well, it could be exceeding the 18. I've seen a lot of younger couples renting apartments, and they both have a vehicle. So you might have more of them who are one-bedroom units looking for that. So in terms of the numbers that are looking for those 8 spaces, are you,
Well, you know, and again, I don't think they're going to limit extra spaces to multi-bedroom units, but that's ultimately up to them. If a one-bedroom unit has two cars and they're first to the, you know, first to request it, then perhaps they get it. So, I mean, you know, they're going to have to manage it appropriately, but again, having a mad scramble for, because you know what's going to happen is when we designate them all visitor, the residents are going to want to use them. And the residents are going to be parking their extra car in a visitor space.
Yep.
And we, I mean, the board has a legitimate interest in making, trying to make sure that that doesn't happen. So what we could, I mean, without trying to figure out precisely how the applicant would prevent that from happening, we can require the applicant to prevent that from happening and require that they report back on how they're doing that at a later date. So this is just occurring to me as we're talking. But I could say the remaining five spaces will be designated as visitor spaces, and the applicant shall manage those spaces so as to ensure that they are not, that they are not regularly occupied by vehicles registered to any resident of the property. So that would require them, as part of their management of the parking, to keep track of, you know, what cars are registered to the people who live in the building, and try to police it in such a way that those spaces aren't used up by people who live in the area.
Are you talking about all 13 or just the five visitor spots?
We can keep talking about how many are visitor and how many are
right.
Can be rented out as second spaces, but whatever number is designated as visitor, I can add in some language requiring the applicant to police that in some form, in some way, and report back to the, you know, to the town how they're doing that and how it's working.
Well, I think that the applicant has already stated that there's going to be a manager on site for the property, and that's easier done when you have a manager on site. So.
Yeah, and if the same car is parked in the visitor space every night at 7:30, you know, they ought to be charged with figuring that out and preventing that car from being there, because that's not what those spaces are being set aside for.
So are you saying that are you saying that if we restrict all 13 to visitor spaces, that we then include this report back provision? And that, does it still, well, let me ask you, does it still work if we do all 13?
I guess it does. I was thinking about it as a means of ensuring that the five.
Yeah, that's where I thought you were.
Well and truly visitor parking spaces. Yeah. That's, yeah, that's how the thought first occurred.
And to make the management would have to come back to, in this case, I assume it would be Director of Community Development, which is Julie, on how it's going to be policed for the other eight spaces.
Yep, we already require them to come in and, you know, make a report at 60, 80, and 100% occupancy. And we could add in a specific requirement to that be part of their report. They devise the strategy that will work.
Well, it's even better. If somebody else other than the board is going to be making those decisions, and it'll be up to them and the applicant or the management company.
All right. So with that said, are you comfortable with the language as
the
it
Chris,
is?
No, I'm not.
Adding
but Chris, putting your proposal in there that the remaining eight spaces will be proposed by the applicant. And reporting back to the Director of Community Development on how this is going to be accomplished. Something to that you mentioned.
Yeah, no, he was referring, and I'll let Chris speak to it as well, but I think he was referring only to the five.
Mm-hmm.
For that eight spaces are still gonna be unassigned until 100% occupancy, at which time they can be offered to tenants, those eight. The remaining five will always have to be visitor spaces, and as part of their 60, 80, 100-day report, the applicant, the owner, then has to come back and report to the town how they're policing, making sure that those five spaces are always visitor spaces. Am I on track with that?
That was what I was throwing
out. Okay, so that's what you're saying. So
that reversed.
So right, so the proposal, the discussion on the table is keeping this paragraph and the option to let those eight spaces go to unit owners in, but requiring a little bit more teeth in whatever spaces remain, and I guess we could say at least five remaining as visitor spaces, because who knows, maybe not all eight will be rented out to other tenants.
Yep.
And so at least five, or they'll be required to come back to demonstrate how they're policing at least five of them as solely visitor spaces, and you know, mm-hmm. that they're being maintained as such.
Well, if the rest of the board is going that way,
I haven't heard.
Well, I missed the February 2nd meeting.
Okay.
My initial reaction when I read the paragraph that was there in the first place was that we're micromanaging the property manager. You know, we're telling him what to do in terms of how you park and how to sign the spaces. I certainly think there should be a certain number of visitor spaces. And if somebody's going to park in that visitor space, like some of the cities around Boston, you should have a placard that you get that fits on the dash to signify that you are authorized to park in that space. If you don't have a placard, you got to be towed. Okay? Yeah. But I still think, when I read the recent paragraph, I still say we're micromanaging the developer, we're micromanaging the property manager. We really are. We're telling them how to assign spaces in the building, and there should be a certain number of visitor spaces, and that's fine. But let's not go crazy, would be my thought on it. But you know, whatever you want to try to do is fine with me. I think it's overkill, frankly.
Right. Well, I mean, I as I said from the beginning, I don't mind having that extra restriction regarding the remaining five reporting back to ensure that those are maintained as visitor
right.
spaces.
Right.
But
yeah.
but I think allowing them to open them up, the eight of them up to the residence is fine by
me.
And I think actually is
their decision.
And I think but it's our decision right now, and on behalf of, you know, it's our duty, I think, you know, Chris rightfully said, you know, to kind of protect and try to make sure that we marshal as much parking on site for residents of this building as possible, given the concerns regarding. So
absolutely.
I think having more residents on site, knowing that they have some available spaces on site, is the better way to go. And if we want to just add in that last
sure.
caveat about reporting back at whatever 100 days, whatever it is,
I can do that.
Regarding the remaining five, I think that's not, I don't think that's too micromanaging. I think that still gives them the leeway to get the eight spaces mm-hmm. out to residents if they need to. Any other comments from the board on that? That's probably not exactly where you want it to go, John, but I think that gets us where we need to be.
The proof is in the pudding later on after it's made, mm-hmm. so we'll find out, and we'll have to trust the management company, the applicant, the owner of the property to do that. And I'm sure Julie will hear one way or the other if it's working or not working. So it gets us to the point where we're trying to make this as concise yet locked in as possible, because it is a unique setting, and it is high density. So, yeah. That's fine.
Did you have any other?
No. Those are the
any other thoughts or comments?
No, those are the two. Oh, I had two questions for Chris. One is, as the board chair in the past has always done, all plans are stamped and signed by the chairman of the board.
Yep.
Does the chairman need to stamp all those, or is that part of the regulation that is part of the comprehensive permit that the...
40B is a little bit different than other zoning practice.
Okay.
When you approve a special permit or a variance, you want, for a site plan, you want a final plan that really pins down exactly what's going to happen. In a comprehensive permit, most often you have something less than final construction drawings. And a lot of times you take those less than final plans and you issue a decision that requires them to tweak a few things. So there's going to be a couple changes to what's shown on those plans. So what most decisions do and what this one does as well is require them, it'll approve a set of plans that we will list in this decision before you vote on it. But then requires the applicant to come back with construction drawings later on before it applies for a building permit that are consistent with what you've done but are the final building plans. So I don't see any need for the chair to stamp all those plans, but what we'll do is we'll take pains before you vote to list all of the plans that are the set of plans that you are approving, because it's really going to be the most recent revisions that they've submitted of each sheet. List those in here. That'll, by listing it in the decision, that'll pin them down to those approved plans. And then later on when they come in for a building permit, the building commissioner will engage in the analysis of whether or not the new construction plans that are being submitted are consistent with the plans that you've approved as part of this hearing. Which is a long-winded way of saying no need to sign or stamp.
Okay, that's fine.
Stylistically, while we're on that page, John Durima is the vice chair, Mr. Redfern.
So that error was pointed out to me.
Okay.
I can switch that.
Does every member have to sign off on this, even the associates?
No.
Okay. But they're there, so maybe you can take them out.
Yep.
All right.
And lastly, on page 14, plan changes. I think we had discussed that at the last meeting too, but I think that first paragraph under 14 that you highlighted in red was very well stated.
Thank you.
All right.
It's confusing. The regulations, I can see how it ended up the way it was before. The regulations say that you got to come back into you guys for a one set of regulations dealing with your local hearing says how you come back in for chain plan changes. But then it refers you over when it describes what is substantial and what's not to a separate set of regulations dealing with appeals to the Housing Appeals Committee. So it got a little jumbled, but tried to unpack it.
Good, John?
Yep.
Kathy, did you have any questions or comments? Si, you were not at the last meeting.
Well, I wasn't
there,
but I read through the revised draft when I got back, and there were four comments I gave Chris last night. One of them was on page 10, paragraph 8. I think it was just a mistypo where you left out some verbiage, but what I was reading on that one was that the board finds that the development of this project endanger the public health, safety, blah, 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 blah. It either does or doesn't. I assume it does not.
That should read
the paragraph, so you pick that up.
Yeah, that should be the board finds the development of the project does not endanger the public.
Then the other one I have is page 11, paragraph H. It says additional lighting may be required for safety and security, and I thought that you should be worded to be more specific. Mm-hmm. And you did. You made it such that additional lighting shall be provided as needed to adequately provide for safety and security, which is just being a little more specific.
Yep.
And leaves it wide open. The other one was page 11, paragraph K, said a drainage report was submitted and been reviewed by town engineer and civil engineering. I thought it ought to be submitted and either has been accepted or approved.
Well,
and I guess you wrote it up and approved.
Does the peer review consultant approve anything, though?
I'm thinking more of the town.
I mean, certainly the town engineer, town staff would have some approval authority over that.
You
but
can take the rest of it off if you want.
How about we say reviewed? A drainage report was submitted and has been reviewed and approved by the town engineer, period.
I don't have a problem with that.
That's fine.
And the only last one I had a comment on was page 11, paragraph L. site will be served by town water, sewer, and electric, and by private gas telephone cable. Upgrades may be needed. And I guess my comment was, upgrades needed or upgrades determined and approved? I mean, their approval process in there, who determines when they ever get maybe needed and who approves them?
I confess, I meant to check with Julie before tonight, and
but I
didn't
think
have a chance.
It's a little open loop the way it's written right now, in my opinion.
It's not clear why the utilities would need to be upgraded, but I can.
But if they have to be,
they should be
an approval cycle in there, approved by somebody.
How about to the extent utilities need to be upgraded or revised, those changes shall be subject to the review and approval of the Community Development Department.
Something like that.
Yeah, that's fine.
Something like that. The rest of it I didn't have any problem with. I have an overall problem with the density still. I had it from the day one, but it is what it is. I quit.
You can't quit.
No, I didn't mean it that way.
I know. Thank you, Cy. Eric, did you have any further comment, questions, any additions?
I don't.
All right.
Okay.
So the intent then tonight is to get this into as final can be, and publish it so that when Robert gets back from his, Redfern gets back from his trip, he has an opportunity to take a look at it. And hopefully, if he's got anything else that he needs to add, get them to you before Tuesday. Because we're back here on Tuesday night for the sole purpose to vote it.
Yep.
And that's what we will do.
Okay.
Do we have a, since Tuesday is a Board of Selectmen night?
It's in the burger room.
We'll meet in the burger room?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where's that?
Down by the Public Services Department, by the Town Manager's Office.
Annex. On the annex. Okay, so with that said, that closes the discussion on the 40B, at least until Robert has a chance to look at it. If he has something, he'll talk to you about it. But the rest of the board members are as satisfied as we're going to get with the decision, and we'll come back and vote it on Tuesday unless lightning strikes.
Great.
All right. Thanks, Chris, for all your
hard work and help.
And, thanks to everybody for their patience. Been a long road. What do you got to say?
Just one more. It looks like that there's going to be a peer review building code plan for fire code.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the two that I noticed. But when Cy was mentioning the review, it doesn't specify who is making the final decision on that. So I'm assuming that it's the building commissioner or inspector along with the peer review specialist.
That decision will be made. The decision requires it, so we're entitled to claim it. But that assistance, I think, will be invoked by the building commissioner when they come in for building permits.
And the fire.
Because that's when you first expect them to have fire code.
Gotcha. Okay.
Review caliber plans.
Okay.
All right, anything else? All right, thanks everybody. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
You have a second?
Second.
Second by Kathy. All those in favor? We are adjourned.
Great.
Thank you. Thanks, Ken.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Chris. Appreciate it.